Good morning to everybody. Today we are going through a very particular topic. We are at lecture number six, and today we will deal with the human vision. Why human vision? Because stating that we are in front of our PC screen in order to process and to try to get out information from our images. And so we are staring at all these images. We need to fully understand how the human vision is working in order to understand which are the advantages and, of course, at the same time, also the disadvantages of the human vision. All right, so we can start with a very short introduction. And the introduction starts stating that in the region of the electromagnetic spectrum, comprised between wavelengths ranging between 0.4 and 0.7 microns, that corresponds to the domain of the visible, that is the energy where human vision operates and that our brain translates as colorimetric information, therefore the colors. Considering that the human eye represents the acquisition tool par excellence, and that the man operator and the man interpreter cover a considerable role in the analysis of remote sensing data, the importance of dealing with the essential aspects of the mechanisms of the vision, to which the quantities used in colorimetry is also connected. Quantities that are then found also in the techniques of processing and representation of the same data. For example, the final print that reproduces a real scene is still and always a representation, although to the eye, it appears absolutely faithful to the scene created by the rules of colorimetry. So that means that starting with this operation, of course, to understand how human vision operates is very important, and it's also very important to understand which are the rules in order, for example, to quantify the colors, the components of the colors. So, this is what in this lecture we will have some information. And the topics will range in the human vision basics. And in the next vision, just to finish the parts related to the color aspects, we will introduce the colorimetric approach. So, before starting with the characteristics of the human eye, just to remind you that in the general schema we presented in the first lecture, now we have finished with the last lecture, the interaction between the electromagnetic energy and the surfaces, and now we are just finishing the introductory part of physics. Going through the human vision and the colorimetry, then we will continue with the schema, just trying to understand how the sensors operates, and then how we can extract information from the images, pre-processing the images itself, the data, and then to go through all the different algorithms in order to understand how the information could be extracted by this data. So, talking about the characteristics of the human eye, the eye-brain system represents the basic scheme for each remote sensing instrumentation. The lens of the human eye, that is the crystalline, acts as a lens of an artificial sensor. Take as example, for example, a digital camera, while the iris controls the luminous flux entering through the pupil and therefore plays the role of the diaphragm in the digital camera. So, all the artificial sensor, for example, the digital camera, try to simulate how the data are acquired by our eyes in order to simulate the these different mechanisms, because I mean, why is necessary to simulate? Because as you will see, human eyes is working very good, but then all the images that we are acquiring with artificial sensor will be seen with our eyes. So if we are using something that is working in more or less in the same way of our eye, that will be that when observed with our eyes, I mean, it will be more simpler to understand and to extract information, because these images are acquired in a very similar way in which the human vision works. So it is interesting to note that the optical axis and the view axis do not coincide. In particular, the latter falls into an area of the well-delimited retina, that is, the retina is the layer where the sensor of the detectors of our eyes are located, a dimple called fovea, which covers in the mechanism of vision a very particular role, and we will see this role after a few slides. The retina, which has a membrane structure rich of blood vessels from which the name derives, has the same function in the eye as the photosensitive sensor in a camera, and the observed scene that will be projected on a reduced scale and turned upside down, then sent to the brain in the form of nerve signals, and we have the figure that is able to describe all these things here. You see, this is on the figure we have something that is a section of our eye in which you see, for example, let's say that we are observing a leaf here, you see, and this leaf is by means of the lens here of the crystalline is reprojected in the backwards of our eyes here, of course, upside down. And this is one of the first things that we have to note, because I mean, the optical characteristics of our vision is that is to be a perspective, a central perspective acquisition. That means that of course, when you are observing a particular scene, the scene is reprojected in a smaller scale, of course, on the back of the fovea, here where the retina is, here, upside down. So that means that when all the receptors here that are on the retina are acquiring this kind of electromagnetic energy, from the geometric point of view, when the stimulus is conveyed through the optic nerve to the brain, the first operation that the brain is doing is just to reverse the image from the geometrical point of view. Otherwise, I mean, what we are looking at is, of course, reversed, is upside down. So you see that the pupil and the cornea are in charge for controlling how much energy is entering in the eyes, and then here this muscle here, you see, are something that is very important for our human vision, because it allows the lens, the crystallines, to move across this direction, I mean the optical axis. This movement that is actuated by these muscles allows the changing of the focal length. So, for example, one of the very important things in our eyes is that whenever we are we are observing, I mean, we are one of the main advantages of our eye is that our vision is always focused. So, I mean, it's never defocused, except a very particular occasion. So that means that this is a very nice advantage, because whenever we are observing, or very close object, or very far object, I mean, our vision is always focused. And this focus that is happening in a very real time is devoted to the fact that there are muscles that are moving these lens along the the optical axis here. And when the energy that is projected over this area that is called fovea, over the retina. On this retina, you see, there are cells that are called photoreceptors that are of two types mainly, and they are defined in relation to their shapes. And these photoreceptors in human eye that are on the retina are called cones and rods. All right, the action carried out by the two classes of receptors is specific and differs in relation to the lighting condition. And we can see these things here. So, in full lights, the cones that are characterized by a good spectral and geometric resolution are in charge for the photopic vision, and they are operating mostly while the rods intervene for mostly in low light conditions, having a good radiometric resolution and a limited spectral sensitivity. How we can understand these things here? We will understand the facts that human vision is operating in two different kind of vision. What is called photopic vision, that is characterized by the cones, while when we are observing using the rods, the other photoreceptors, I mean we are facing what is called scotopic vision. And photopic vision and scotopic vision are very different each other, and usually when we are paying attention, usually, and when there are very good lighting condition, we are using the photopic vision while we are not paying very much attention to what we are observing, or when there are a very bad lighting condition, usually we are using scotopic vision. So you see here, these are all the different parts of the human eyes, and you see here we have a section of these retina, and you see here we have the different our sensor. You see these rods that are the green one, and the cone that are the blue and red and green, the green, red and blue one, while the rods are these dark green photoreceptors. The facts that I mean in this representation, the cone are in colors in RGB, in an RGB system that introduce the facts that I mean there are some scientific hypotheses in which I mean our vision is working similarly to an RGB system. But we will see that in the next slides. All right, receptors cones typically active during the day and responsible for the chromatic component of vision, so that means colors, based on the differential absorption of the pigment contained in them, are divided into three families and are called type S, stand for short, type M, medium, and type L, long. As represented in the diagram of the following figure, each of the three families is specialized in perceiving radiances in different wavelengths, ranges in the different wavelength ranges, and with different spectral resolution, with peaks respectively at 0.44 microns or 440 nanometers for small and medium wavelengths in the blue band, around 0.54 microns for medium in the green band, and about 0.58 microns, that is in the yellow color tone for medium long ones. As shown in the diagram, each of the three families is specialized in perceiving radiances in different wavelengths. And you see, these are the wavelengths that we are using. So, This is the distribution of the spectral sensitivity of the three types of chromatic receptors, and you see, as usual, here we have on the x-axis wavelengths, and in all these lectures, so in lecture number 6, and you will see also in lecture number 7, the limitation of these two lectures is that whatever we are introducing in these two different lectures is limited, of course, to 0.4 to 0.7 microns, because we are talking only about the visible, not above the visible, because I mean we are only interested in human eyes and human vision, and we are interested in the next lecture, in lecture number 7, on how we can represent quantitatively the colors. So I mean we are only interested in the visible spectral band. So you see that in the y-axis we have a sort of sensitivity that is measured in accordance with how the different photoreceptors are sensitive, what we introduced before, and this is the curve that is representing the sensitivity of the three different photoreceptors in the visible. You see the blue receptor, the green receptor, and what is called the red receptor, that in reality has a maximum of sensibility in the yellow band. And this yellow band, the maximum peak of sensitivity, is also related to the fact that our artificial source of energy, that is used for human vision, for example, when we are outside, that is the sun, is emitting with this particular peak of emission in, you remember, 0.55 microns. And the peak of sensibility of the human vision is again in this interval of wavelengths, in the middle of the green in the red receptor, a peak, and this is the same of the peak of emission of the sun. That means that the human vision adapts itself to the maximum emission of the sun, and so this is very important because the human vision is was built just to during the evolution process in order to work in a better condition when we have a very clear sky, when the sun is shining, and during daylight condition, while of course human vision is working very badly during the night, because I mean we don't see anything without any artificial any natural source of illumination. So these are the three sensitivity of our different photoreceptors, and the value composed of the three different sensitivity portion produce the global average spectral sensitivity diagram of the human eye during photopic vision, as shown in the following figure, and we will see this figure. This curve essentially covers the whole spectrum of the visible, with peak sensitivity in yellow-green at the wavelength of 0.55 microns, practically close to the maximum value of solar irradiance at sea level, as I mentioned just a few minutes ago. This is an evident demonstration of the natural adaptation of the human vision system to the surrounding environment, of course. According to this fact, the yellow-green is, for example, the color of the fog lights, that is to say, of maximum sensitivity, while the red, on the contrary, is the color that received maximum attention of a psychological nature, as it remembers the blood or the fire, and therefore the danger, but certainly not because of its particular sensitivity of the eyes. So that means that, for example, let's see, the average sensitivity, and you see this is the sensitivity, the spectral sensitivity of our eyes in general. So again, here we are at the range of visible 0.4, 0.7 around, and you see this is the the sensitivity of our eyes in a range of 0 and 1, and in red we have the curve of the photopic vision vision, and in blue the curve for the scotopic vision. So I mean using cones and rows, cone for the red and rows for the blue. So you see that I mean the maximum sensitivity of the eye is in 0.55, that is the maximum peak of emission of the this is the peak of the emission of the sun. And you see that away from the central wavelength, so in the blue part of the spectrum and in the red part of the spectrum, the sensitivity of the human eyes is quite low, because you see that this curve is quite similar to a Gaussian, to a normal distribution. And this is the photopic vision, so using cones. When we are using rods, you see we are assisting to a shift to a very to shorter wavelengths of these curves you see here. So the peaks is now in around 5.5 microns. That means that we are in the border of blue and green, and I mean the sensitivity is greater in the blue and in the green band, and is very low in the red band with scotopic vision. So I mean it's very difficult to me for me in this lesson just to make you clear how photopic and scotopic vision is actuated, but I will explain you vis-a-vis or in cam how we can force our vision to pass from the natural vision that we are using, that is the photopic, to the scotopic vision, in order to make you clear, more clear, how the, we are using this vision. But this is the mean sensitivity in the whole visible spectrum of the two kind of visions. Starting from these curves here, you have also to understand the very important things. So you will see that when in few slides, when we will face the RGB system, I mean you will understand that for every single point of this curve in correspondence, you see here, look at the mouse, of the different colors, every single wavelength in the visible is representing the color dominant. So that means that here, for example, in point 54, we have a wavelength that is our eyes is representing that by the energy that is coming to the retina with a green color. And you see we are ranging from blue to green to yellow, orange and red. So every single wavelength is the dominant of a particular color. So that means that how many wavelengths we have from 0.4 to 0.7. Of course, in this smaller part of the electromagnetic spectrum, we have infinite wavelengths, of course. I mean, because here, in these very short ranges of wavelengths, we have infinite wavelengths, because it's continuous, the distribution. So that means, just with a simple paradigm, to understand that the number of colors that our eyes could catch is infinite, because they are infinite, the wavelengths that are in these intervals of wavelengths. And I mean, it's very difficult to understand why we can, or if it's really true, the fact that we can catch infinite color. But we have a very simple proof in order to understand that. Because if you are looking at whatever color you want, if there's a color, of course, your eye is looking at and is observing these things as a color, because he has a color. So I mean, whatever you can observe, for example, think about a panel and you are staring at a panel. If I'm painting this panel in different colors, I mean, if they are colored, you will see as in colored. And of course, you can catch an infinite quantity of colors. But another thing, and this is what is representing this sensitivity, this human eye sensitivity diagrams, Another thing is that, I mean, in the central wavelengths of the visible here, in the yellow part of the spectrum, you can catch, just because the eye is more sensitive than in other wavelengths, you can catch more tones of the same colors as different. So if you are seeing, for example, two different tones of green, we can catch the difference of the two tones of greens. That means that, of course, both the colors are seen as colors, of course, but in the green, in the middle part of the visible, so from 0.5 to 0.6 microns in the green subspectral bands, we can catch more tones of the same colors and to see that as different colors. So, for example, when we are using green colors, so with our eyes is capable to see more differences in the green different tones. So we can catch as different more green tones than in the other, because in the blue here and in the red part of the spectrum, our eye, being so less sensitive in with regards to the central part of the visible, is not able to catch so many different blue tones and red tones. So that means that two different blue tones can catch, of course, as colors, as blue colors, but to our eyes, being with different tones, appears to be the same colors, just because here our eye is very poor sensitive, like in the red. So if we have two different tones of reds, of course we can catch these two tones as colors, as red colors, but maybe we cannot catch the difference. So we see these different red tones colors as the same red, and this is because, I mean, the sensitivity of our eyes here is very low. So you see, this is the photopic and the scotopic spectral sensitivity of our eye. So in the same figure is also represent the trend of the spectral sensitivity of the eye during the scotopic vision. So due essentially to roles, because we mentioned that the photopic vision is based on the usage of cones. As as can be seen, the peak shift towards shorter wavelengths, I mentioned that, around 0.5 microns in blue-green, in correspondence with the typical colors of darkness and nights. The rods also have a very strong radiometric sensitivity, in order of 1,000 times greater than that of the cones, to be able to capture even the smallest light signal. Therefore, they are active, especially in conditions of darkness. For this reason, for example, the lights of airport runways of emergency vehicle are blue-violet. Why they are blue-violet? Let's see that. Because, I mean, if the scotopic vision is actuated during a very dark condition in the darkness, of course all the lights that are representing, for example, as mentioned before, the lights of airport, runway, or emergency vehicle are blue-violet. Why that? Because during the night, you see the sensitivity in the red part of the spectrum is very low, so it's moved to this condition here, to the blue one. So it's better our sensitivity curves says that it's better, we are more sensitive to the blue part of the spectrum instead of the red. So that's why, I mean, these lights are in a blue tone in order to be better viewed by our eye. A very particular situation is that at dusk or dawn, when the two types of vision, photopic and scotopic, partially overlap, without either of them having the upper hand, making the vision particularly difficult. So I mean, in this particular condition, when the sun is very is very low on the horizon, I mean, we have a partial overlapping of the two vision. And so, I mean, you know, by experience, that the vision is very difficult in that particular conditions. I'm sorry, the displacement that is observed in the maxima of the two curves passing from the photopic vision to the scotopic one is also known as the Purkinje effect. You see here in bold, it's the name of the scientist who studied the sensitivity of the human eyes. And so, I mean, the shift of the peak of sensitivity of the human eyes in the two kind of vision from larger to smaller wavelengths is called Purkinje effect. It's interesting to note that the distribution of cones and rods on the retina is not uniform, but specific and with variable density. And this is very important, but just before seeing how much is important, I just want to check if we are recording. Yes, we are half an hour, so we can continue. So, we mentioned the fact that the cones and rods distribution is very different, and the cones being appointed to a vision of precision where the details to be explored appears to be well lit and therefore also rich in chromatic information, as in the diurnal vision, mostly occupy the cones the area of the fovea, coinciding with the view axis which subtends about 2 degrees of the central portion and thin out towards the periphery. So that means that all the cones that are very small, and there are very large numbers, are located on the retina in the fovea area that is very close to the optical axis. And this is very important. Their dimension of the cones vary according to their position, up to values of 1 micron for those located in the fovea, which corresponds to a geometric limit resolving power of 1,000 lines 4 millimeters, but we will see that in another lecture, a respectable capacity comparable with the best available optical system, but still less than that of a bird of prey that reaches a resolving power of 3 or 4 times higher. So that means that, I mean, this is a very good resolution of our sensor, so we can have a very good vision, but this vision is for example not so good as, for example, for birds that are very good acuity, vision acuity, that is hallows them just to see very small details from very large distances. So the rods, on the contrary, are responsible for the achromatic vision. So that means that using the rods, we are not using all the possibilities that we have in achromatic vision. So I mean to catch colors, but it is a sort of achromatic vision. So something that is very similar to a grayscale vision. And these rods are distributed starting from the edge of the fovea, or the edges of the fovea, thickening towards the periphery of the retina, up to a maximum density at the limit of the visual field of the eye. This explains why, for the purpose of a better observation of objects in full darkness, for example, the dim light of the stars, after the necessary initial adaptation, the peripheral part of the retina is preferably used to the so-called tail of the eye, and turn the head slightly with respect to the normal view axis. And this is to avoid using the central part of the fovea, where all the intents and purposes, there is a total absence of rods, a real blind hole for night vision. So I mean, we are using that when the condition of illumination is very poor, and so we are using scotopic vision, for example, just enlarging and trying to enlarge in the pupils where we are in very dark condition, in order to to increase the quantity of energy that is going to the roads in order to make them sensitive. So I mean, it's very think about when you are trying to see something in the darkness. The first things that we are doing is just trying to enlarge the pupil in order to acquire more energy as possible, in order to have more energy that is going to the roads. While when we are in very good lighting condition, for example, just outside in a very clear day, in a very during daytime with a very sunny day, I mean our eyes are tends to close. I mean we are close the pupils. I'm trying to close the eyes and the pupils in order to reduce the quantity of energy that will impact over the cones, because I mean there's much energy, so we need to control the quantity of energy. Otherwise, if you are enlarging the pupils, we will see a saturated image. So that means a very high quantity of lights that is enable us to see anything. So I mean we have a saturated image. So also the possibility to open and close the eyes is due to the fact that we are trying to control in a very automatic way, because we cannot really fully control the movements of our eyes. It's a sort of automatic control of the energy that is striking over our sensors. But it's very important, you see here, the distribution that you have in these figures. You see here, so as described, this is the retina in the back part of the eyes, and you see the cones, you see are placed. This is the perspective of this area, are placed here in the fovea part, so they are here in proximity of the optical axis, while the rods, you see, they are in a peripheral part. So that means, and this is very simple to understand, that we are using cones not only when we are in a very good illumination condition, but also in a particular condition. You see, if the cones are here, that means that if this is the center, the optical center of our lens, of the crystalline, and I remind you that this is a central perspective vision from the geometrical point of view, that means that I mean the energy is passing from here, and the optical axis are projected over the cones. That means that when we are using the cones, the angle here is smaller if when we are using the rods, because for using the rods we need to enlarge this angle. And enlarging this angle, that means that we are looking at with a very large field of view, you see here. So when we have a very large field of view, that means that we are using the rods. When we are a very small field of view, we are using the cones, just because they are placed in that particular position on the retina. What does it mean to have a very small field of view? A very small field of view means that you are zooming in, so you are reducing the embracing angle of the scene. So zooming in for our human vision means to pay attention to what you are looking at. So if you are, for example, reading, you are zooming in on the letters, on the words. So zooming in, you are using your cones. And so that means that you are using a photopic vision that is characteristics of a fully colorimetric vision when you are catching all the different colors. When you are enlarging this angle, so if you have a very large field of view, that means, for example, that is typical when you want to embrace a very large scene. So, for example, if you are on the top of the mountains and you want to see the panorama, so you are enlarging the vision. If you are enlarging the vision, so you are using a very large field of view, you are using the roads, so you are using a scotopic vision. That means that the scotopic vision is a sort of achromatic, let's say achromatic vision, in which of course you can see the colors, but the colors are not contrasted as in the photopic vision. Let's try to do that. Let's to open, try force your vision to open the field of view, and you will check that the correspondent resolution of the image that you are looking at, geometrical resolution, I mean, is lower with the scotopic vision, just because, I mean, the rods are bigger than the cones. And so, I mean, it's just like having an output image with a larger cell, so with a lower geometrical resolution on the ground. But as mentioned before, I will explain that just in front of you, because it's very difficult to explain that without make you feel how you can pass from photopic to scotopic vision. But this is the explanation from a geometric point of view. The light signal, therefore, affects the photoreceptors that occupy the first layer of the retina, the rear one, with respect to the origin of the lights. There are two other layers in the retina that are occupied by two sets of nerve elements, bipolar cells and ganglion cells, as described in the schematic section of the previous video, so remember when we have a section of the retina, whose task is to transmit the information or the data to the optic nerve as if they were real telephone wires gathered to one big cable. I'm sorry. The two optic nerves, coming respectively from the right and the left eye, meet in the optic chiasma, where each of them is divided into two parts, separating the information of the right half and the left half of the visual field of each eye. This is the following figures. So you see, this is the functioning of the two chiasma. So you see, we have two eyes, fortunately, and we have these two optical nerves, the blue and the red, that are coming from these fins here. And this is the optic tract and the chiasm. And you see that the energy, because it's a sort of energy that is transmitted, because I mean the photoreceptors that are proteins are stimulated by this energy that is striking over the cones and rods, and the energy, of course, in the visible spectral band is reacting. This protein is reacting, and they are changing tension, and this tension is going through these nerves, these optical nerves, to the cortex of the brain. And you see, in the brain, we have two different signals that are coming from the images that is catched by left and by right eyes. So that means that we have two different images, and at the end, here in the primary visual cortex, the two images are fused together. So I mean, still here, the images are divided into what we are seeing with the red, with the right, and what we are seeing with the left part and with the left eye. And then here in the primary visual cortex, the two images are fused together. And they are fused together, as we will see later on, to have a 3D vision. So that means a vision that is able to see also the third dimension. The effective understanding of the mechanisms of vision is still an open problem, because you know it's very difficult to measure the sensitivity of cones and rods, because I mean they are very small, and it's not really simple to test, for example, sensitivity or the way in which the human vision is working, because I mean it's not easy to fully understand the mechanism. But it seems, because it's not sure, that in the presence of a photochemical type of reaction, for which particular pigments, whose photoreceptors are impregnated in different ways in rods, are called rhodopsin and are discolored or bleached when struck by a flow, bright even very small, like that of a single proton. So I think that, for example, for rods, there are these rhodopsin che are in some way discolored by a visible flux of energy, and so they are it is believed that to activate a rhodopsin molecule, the protein responsible for vision and contained in the rods, a single photon with a wavelength of 0.55 microns is sufficient, and therefore an energy of about this quantity, barely two orders of magnitude greater than that developed in molecular shocks in Brownian motion. So that means that in order to activate the rhodopsin, so the protein that is able with a photochemical reaction to exchange a tension, so an electrical flux, to the optic nerves, is enough a single proton of energy, so a very small quantity of energy. That means that our eyes, I mean our sensors, are very sensitive to this quantity of energy. And during this, you see here in bold, this widening process, the pigments, which are continuously regenerated, of course, because if they are bleached or discolored, we need even and always more rhodopsin in order to continue to use the human vision, produce chemical substances capable of stimulating the nerve endings and therefore of transmitting qualitative and quantitative information such as spectral and luminous intensity through nerve impulses at increasing frequencies. So I mean there's an exchange of electrical tension that is able and is ranging with different frequencies in order to go through the optical nerves to the brains and to give to the brains some stimulus that are in charge for forming the images of what we are actually looking at with our eyes. So, in conclusion, while the structural and functional wonders of the eye never cease to amaze, its limits are well known and can be summarized in some points. So, till now, we saw that our vision is has many, many different advantages. So, I mean, very high sensitivity, the possibility to focus in real time without any problem, as we will see later on, the possibility to have a stereoscopic vision and the possibility to use also in different conditions two different kinds of vision, the photopic and the scotopic ones. But there are also some disadvantages, and we need to list the disadvantages because we need to understand which are the limits of our vision, especially in our case when we are staring at images on our PC screen. So, which are these disadvantages? The first one is that the sensitivity of the retina is confined to a small part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and we know that, although very significant for the surrounding environment in the visible range, and varies according to the wavelength with a peak of 0.55 microns and from person to person. So, I mean, one of the bigger limits and disadvantages of our vision is the fact that it's confined in a very smaller part of the electromagnetic spectra, and that also that I mean the sensitivity, as we've seen before, is not constant. So, I mean, it's ranging in different wavelengths, and for example, in the blue and in the red part of the spectrum, I mean, the sensitivity of the human eyes is very low. And then, as we will see in the next lecture, this sensitivity is ranging from person to person. So, I mean, it's not constant. And so there are also people, for example, the daltonic ones, that are a very small sensitivity in the red part of the visible spectrum. So I mean, they cannot see as the average of the people the red tones in a correct way, or what is considered in a mean value to be correct. Furthermore, the human eye is able, on average, to distinguish some millions of different colors. You see that some millions means for us an infinite quantity of colors, but only a couple of hundreds of grays, as long as the lateral range contiguously. Otherwise, its capacity is reduced to a few dozen samples. So that means that, I mean, we can see millions of colors, as I mentioned before. That means for us, as again mentioned, an infinite quantity of colors, if they are seen separately. So whenever we have a colors, we are facing a colors, we can understand that this is a color. So we can see an infinite quantity of colors, millions of colors. But if you are seeing close to each other different colors, I mean, our capacity, the capacity of the human eye, is extremely decreased. So when we are looking more colors, we are able to see few hundreds of different colors as different. Of course, we are see that they are all colors. But for example, if we are seeing some hundreds of blue, for example, we can recognize as different blue, different tones of blue, a very small part. So that means that when we are observing many colors, our eyes is able to recognize as different colors, as different colors of tones of colors, a few hundreds. This is the problem. And another thing that is mentioned here, when we are looking at gray tones, and you see that we have experience in the labs that sometimes it's very important to display images in gray colors. Of course, we can see an infinite quantity of grays if seen separately, of course. But when we are representing these images, for example, in the case of the labs, with 256 different gray tones, in reality, our eye is able to distinguish few dozens of these different gray tones. So we are not able to distinguish the full 256 different gray tones, but a quantity that is smaller than this quantity of the origin. So also the eyes has this limit that is related to the possibility to distinguish a very small quantity of different colors and different gray tones. The second limit is related to the existence of a sort of automatic brightness control, that is the variation of the pupil diameter as a function of the incident light, which does not allow for impartial comparison of lights. What does that mean? That means a very simple thing. That I mean, the dimension of the pupil, that in human eye is very reduced, this possibility to change the dimension of the pupil, in comparison, for example, with cats. You know that cats during day are a very small pupil that is really similar to a line, while during the night they are enlarging this pupil in order to acquire as much energy as they can, as you will see, as you can see on the on the paper that you have, on the material that you have available, on the remote sensing basic that you have available on the portal. But I mean, in human vision, these small changes of the dimension, that means the quantity of energy that is striking over our receptors, is not controlled by ourselves, but is fully automatic. So we cannot control that. So that means that if I'm looking at a particular color, for example, a colored panel, in different lighting condition, the results, for example, outside in a sunny day,
or in a room in a lab with artificial lighting with different illumination condition, that means that if seen in these two different conditions, the color panels appears to be different to our eyes. So that means that in different lighting condition we cannot have, and technically, as is written here, we cannot compare in an impartial way the colors, for example, the lights, because our vision, as we will see in the next lecture, is heavily conditioned by the illumination, a condition in which we are seeing the scene. So this is the limitation related to this automatic brightness control we have. There are also some other limitation, and one of them is the variability of chromatic sensitivity as a function of ambient light, so that the ability to discriminate colors decrease strongly in poor light environments. That means that, I mean, our possibility to distinguish different colors is decreasing with the reduction of the lighting condition. So in the darkness, of course, we are not able to distinguish as many colors as we can distinguish during, for example, the daytime. So that means that, of course, our vision is depending also in the chromatic vision, so in the possibility to catch different colors with the illumination condition. Then we have also some limitation related to the angle of view. Even though it is physically constant, can be increased, if one can say so, by effects of the movement of the eyeballs, while due to the attention to the brain placed on certain details, it also can be reduced to only corner that embrace those details. So I mean, also the angle of view is limiting us, because I mean, when we are using different view angle, of course, if you are zooming in or zooming out, we have different condition of vision. For example, we are switching, enlarging the field of view from photopic to scotopic vision. But also, if we are looking at, I mean, a scene not perpendicularly but with a very strong inclination, of course, the energy that is coming to our eyes, and we saw that when we approach the topics related to the interaction between electromagnetic energy and surfaces, of course, the energy that is coming to our eyes is a function of the cosine of the incident lights. So I mean, if we are observing for a very inclined way, of course, the energy that is coming to our eyes there'll be lower than if observed in a perpendicular position. I'm sorry. Okay, the last one is the presence of memory. Experience and the so-called preconception also makes the whole eye brain affected by systematic errors, variable from person to person and very difficult to assess. Even cultural, environment, and educational factor take over the judgment on the images, strongly influenced by objectivity and repeatability of an observation. So, one limit is also, at least at the beginning, the presence of memory. So, for example, during the lab, maybe you never saw a false color image, for example, the 432 in the RGB channel synthesis using Landsat data. And first time, I mean, to see the vegetation all in red seems strange. And so at the beginning, I mean, having no memory of this kind of vision could be difficult to catch different objects just at the beginning. But then the memory, when you are used to see some particular object and some particular colors, you can memorize these things here, and then that will help your vision. But of course, at least at the beginning, beginning, I mean, when I'm looking at something that I don't know, of course it make me the impossibility to extract information about on what I'm seeing. So for example, if I see a very strange shape and I don't know what this shape is, of course that means that I'm not extracting any information. After seeing several times and having access to the information on what these things here, then I can recognize that also in other, for example, in other shapes. So I can generalize that. So if I know what a cat is, I can understand different type of cats, different kind of cats, different dimension or whatever. So I mean, when I'm extracting for the first time the information, then I can store this information, and it's a sort of vision memory. So just continue to, for example, observe a remotely sense image. I mean, I can train my brain to recognize object, so to extract information. But at the beginning, of course, this is a very large limit. So in a vision theory, the color vision implies relational mechanisms and functions between the structural part of the eye that are not completely clarified to this day. The basic problem consists in understanding how the eye, whose structural and functional framework is well known, is able to transmit a different and specific nerve stimuli to the brain for each different wavelength of light that affects the retina. So I mean, it's quite difficult to understand how is the how our vision is working. I'm sorry. On the subject, there are several theories, all more or less fascinating, in search of correlating experimental and functional effects with the physiology and anatomy of the eye-brain system. For example, to better understand the theory of trichromatic or components formulated at the beginning of the 19th century by Young and von Helmholtz, it is useful to remember that at that time some mechanisms of composition of the colors on which the theory itself is based were well known. So just at that time they already known some rules for the composition of colors. In particular, it was known experimentally and non-theoretically, starting from three very precise starting colors, blue, green and red, an infinity of other colors could be created, including white. So you see that starting from three colors, we can produce an infinity of other colors. All this simply by modulating the power of the three light beams related to the basic colors, which are therefore defined primary colors by addition. So I mean that if you are, as we will see in the next lecture, if you are producing three light beams just in the three principal colors, and you are modulating the intensity of these three light beams, you can produce an infinity of colors. And this production of infinite number of colors is called the addition, the color addition techniques that is based on these three colors that are called primary colors. And in this table, you have all the possible combination of colors, starting from the three principal colors, so blue, green and red. So if you have this color combination and you can pass through an additive color composition, you can add to the same quantity of blue and green to have the complementary color of blue and green that is called cyan. If you are composite blue and red in the same quantity, you will have the complementary color that is called magenta. And if you are adding and you are synthesizing the same quantity on green and red, you will get the third complementary color, that is the yellow. And if you are adding the same quantity, and this quantity are saturated, that means that are the maximum of the quantity, and the same for the blue, green, and red, you will get the white. If you are not adding a saturated quantity, that means the same quantity of blue, green, and red, but this is not the maximum, you will get a gray tones. All right, if blue, green, and red are null, you will get the black, that is one of the gray tones. So in order to fully understand and to easy easier the possibility to learn the complementary color, you have to think that, for example, you can think about the complementary color as the primary that is not in the sum. So for example, cyan is the complementary color of red, magenta is the complementary color of green, yellow is the complementary color of blue. So it's more easier to learn that thing. So if you are thinking about the complementary as the complementary color of one of the principles, so again, cyan is the complementary of red, or red is the complementary of cyan, vice versa, magenta is the complementary of green, yellow is the complementary of blue. You can understand that also because we can also think about a subtractive techniques that is used, for example, when we are using, for example, printer or plotter. Why that? Because they are usually print on white piece of paper. So I mean they are starting from a white color, and so the white color is the sum of blue, green, and red. And if you are subtracting from white the red, what you will get? You will get cyan, because the white is blue plus green plus red. You see, the cyan is blue plus green, so these three things here, minus blue and green, it remains the red. So if you are subtracting the red to the white, what is remaining is blue plus green. That means that you will get the cyan in a subtractive system. If you are subtracting the green to the white, so I mean you are subtracting this component, you will get a blue plus red. Blue plus red is of course the magenta. If you are subtracting the blue to the white, you will get the yellow. That is, you see here, green plus red. So that's why it's more easier to understand which is the complementary of which primary, just thinking about the subtractive system. And if of course you are subtracting the white and you are subtracting all the three principal colors, you will get of course the black. So this table is very useful in order to understand the principal and complementary colors. Of course, if you are adding, or if you are subtracting, in this case, if you are adding three different components of blue, green, and red, you will have as a result whatever color, an infinite quantity of color, of course. While when you are subtracting from white another colors, you will get another colors, of course. All right. if on the one hand the trichromatic model is able to explain some experimental facts, such as, for example, size defects in red and green, now with a generic term of color blindness, and the production of complementary colors due to selective retinal fatigue. On the other hand, this fails to explain other phenomena, such as the effect of persistence of colors and relative contrast. So, I mean, there are some problems in using this vision theory. I don't want to go in depth in this concept, but just to mention that there are some problems. However, even if we complete, the model of Young-Helmholtz has from its simplicity the reference according to which the human eye is able to incorporate all the wide range of colors, or rather their sensations, through activation of three photoreceptors sensitive to the three fundamental colors, blue, green, and red. So the three, for example, cones, type of cones, that according to the Young and Helmholtz models are sensitive to the three different components of the visible, blue, green, and red. I'm sorry. Therefore, it is sufficient to recall the practical usefulness of these principles on which the most common techniques of visualization of images are founded, be they television or projective additive synthesis, or the same photographic or printing processes, subtractive combination, as you see, as I mentioned before. So based on this young Helmholtz theory, they are based the whole the our synthetic system that are representing images. For example, TV or screen are using an RGB synthesis, an RGB composition, while, for example, as mentioned before, printers or plotters are using a subtractive combination because they are simply printing on white supports. Just to conclude the lecture, we need to introduce the stereoscopic vision. So if you try to quickly grab an object placed a short distance away, keeping one eye closed, you will hardly succeed in the first attempt. So I mean, if you are closing one of our eyes, you are failing to grab an object. In fact, looking at only one eye, there is no sense of relief that allows us to accurately assess the distance and the shape of an object. If you look at an object closely, closing one eye first and then the other, you will get the impression that the object is moving. Let's try to do that. So if you are closing first the left eye and then the right eye, you will see that the object seems to move. If you repeat the experiment, looking at object at very far away, you will notice a minimal difference between the two images, so in the position of the object you are looking at. Looking then with both eyes open, it can be seen that in the first case the sense of relief is very pronounced, while in the second is very weak. So I mean, when you are looking at an object, if you are very far away, I mean you have a very small sense of the third dimension, while if you are looking that from a very close distance, I mean you have a very huge sense of the third dimension. So to understand this phenomenon, consider each retina separately. In observing a point object, fixation point, this falls in the center of your visual field and will form an image of the retina. So all the stereoscopic vision, all the points of space located to the right, left, above and below the fixation points, we stimulate the retinal cells located respectively to the left, to the right, below and above the retina due to the reversal of the image. Remember that there's an upside down position of the image that we are observing due to the central perspective that we are using, they are formed using our crystalline, our lens. Since each stimulated retinal point determines visual sensation, in turns interpreted as cortical level through the optic nerve and always referred to the same direction of the visual field, depending on the position that this point have on the retina, and since the stimuli on the corresponding retinal points in the two eyes are located in equal direction, the two retinal images of the same object are finally transposed and superimposed like a single image, binocular vision. So that means that when you are looking at from a very short distance an object and you are simply close the two eyes, you see this object that is moving. I mean, the position seems to be different. So that means that if we are using our vision, we are catching the scene from two different points of view, and these different points of view are related to the different position of our eyes. I mean, with this interpupillar distance that we have between the center of our pupils. So if you are getting the same image, I mean the same scene from two different points of view, you remember that the two acquisitions that are done by the two different eyes are differentiated till to the chiasma, and then they are fused in the same image. And if they are fused in the same image, we can have a stereoscopic vision. So if we have this stereoscopic vision, so if we are observing the same point from the two different point of view, we can reconstruct a triangulation. That means the connection, if you are looking at a single point, of course, starting from the central point of our two crystallines, of our two eyes, there are two rays that are forming a triangle, a space triangle. So that means that, having this spatial triangle, that means that we can understand if this point is closer to our eyes with respect to another point. And so we have, using two eyes, this stereoscopic vision that, from the practical point of view, is having the sense of depth. So just understanding from these triangulating things that we have, these triangulating effects, what is closer to our eyes and what is more distant from our eyes. So we cannot measure that because it's not an active system and we cannot measure wavelengths, but we can at least understand what is closer and what is more distant than that. So the sense of depth, that is very important in order to have a 3D views. All right, so with that we consider finished the lecture number 6. So I'm just after 1 hour and more or less 15 minutes as usual, we are considering closed the lecture number 6. So as usual, take care and of course, never give up. Bye bye.